Good evening, sci-fi movie nerds, and welcome to another episode of the Sci-Fi Movie Guy. My name is Mike, and this is weekly show number 35, and let's get started as we always do with Star Wars news. So our first story today is Star Wars Rebels has released the titles and synopsis for the last five episodes on Season 3, Star Wars Rebels, and I'm a bit surprised at their order, so let's go through them. Episode 18, Secret Cargo. When a routine refueling mission goes wrong, the Ghost crew finds themselves transporting an important rebel leader across the galaxy, pursued by Imperial warships. Episode 19, Double Agent Droid. Chopper and AP-5 team up to infiltrate an Imperial station to steal needed codes, but an Imperial specialist turns the droids against the crew to cause chaos. Episode 20, Twin Suns. Reacting to a vision of Maul, Ezra defies Hera and Kanan to travel to a remote planet in hopes of stopping the former Sith Lord from carrying out his plans. Episode 21, Zero Hour, Part 1. In final preparations for their attack on Lothal, Phoenix Squadron's plans are disrupted when Grand Admiral Thrawn discovers their location. And Episode 22, the final episode of the season, trapped on Atollan with the rebel base under siege, Hera and Kanan fight to keep the squadron alive as Ezra attempts to rally help from an unexpected source. So, to me, they just released these this week. And to me, it's very surprising because I assumed that the Obi-Wan Maul episode would be the last episode of the season. But to me, what it's looking like from these is that Twin Suns, so the third last episode of the season, will probably be the Maul Obi-Wan, and I think it might even get resolved there, but then Ezra's going to stay on Tatooine for the next two episodes, or at least for Zero Hour, talking to Obi-Wan, convincing him to try to come back and help the rebellion at the end of season three. That's what it seems like to me. I'm excited if this is how it goes, because the sooner I get to see Obi-Wan kill Maul, the better. But tell me what you think in the comments section. What do you think the final part of season three for Rebels is going to be? So let's get into the next story in Star Wars news. And the all-new Star Wars-themed lands at Disney Park and Disney Hollywood Studios are scheduled to open in 2019. Disney Chairman and CEO Bob Iger made the announcement this week. The Star Wars-themed lands are the largest ever single-themed land expansions at Disneyland and Walt Disney World Resorts. The Walt Disney Company's website said, at each location, guests will be transported to a never-before-seen planet, a remote trading post, and one of the last stops before Wild Space, where Star Wars characters and their stories come to life. Now, so happy to hear this. I actually heard it was going to be in 2020 that they came out, but I'm even happier that it's going to be 2019, because then they'll have a little bit of time to get it rolling and get it perfect, because I'm planning on going there in May of 2021. That's going to be when my 50th birthday is, and that's my birthday present to myself, is I'm going to go to Star Wars Land for a week, and obviously Disneyland too, but I'm going to go to the LA area, check out Star Wars World, and I'm really excited about it. I know everybody says, oh, why are you going to wait till you're 50, but you know what? I just want that to be my 50th birthday present. So tell me if you're excited for Star Wars Land and Star Wars World at Disney Parks. I'd love to hear what you have to think. And our last story in Star Wars news, and it's Collider.com reports the filmmakers behind the slapstick movies Date Night, Epic Movie, and Meet Spartacus have now Star Wars in their sights, as writers-directors Jason Freeberg and Aaron Seltzer are prepping Star Wars Episode XXXIVE equals MC squared, The Force Awakens, The Last Jedi Went Rogue. Seltzer and Freeberg will write and direct the spoof, which is aiming to start filming this fall. The two are credited with writing the first Scary Movie in 2000, but that film and its sequel got heavy rewrites from the Wayans brothers that made them worthwhile endeavors. Seltzer and Freeberg made their directorial debut with the rom-com spoof Date Movie, which was followed by Epic Movie and then Meet the Spartans, and a Twilight spoof called Vampires Suck. Why am I reporting this story, you ask? Well, Star Wars has been spoofed before, and it's been spoofed very well. Family Guy did it, Robot Chicken has done it. I'm sure you guys will tell me in the section. I know Lego did a little bit of Star Wars, which was cool. But these guys are idiots. They don't make good movies. They're horrible. And if Star Wars Lucasfilm doesn't put a stop to this, it's going to be really sad because you know what? There are other movie writers and directors out there that I think would do a much better job. I would love to see a full Lego Star Wars movie. That I would be completely on board with. I went and saw the Lego Batman movie, a couple days ago, and it was a phenomenal movie. It gets a little slow in the third act, but you know what? All in all, for what it is, highly recommend you go see it. And I would highly love to see a Lego Star Wars movie. But these guys, oh my God, I hope they get hit by a train because I do not want this movie to be made. I hope Lucasfilm can stop it somehow because it is just absurd that these two are going to try their hand at Star Wars. They're just awful writers and directors. That's all I'm going to say about that. And then we get into sci-fi news today. So in our first story in sci-fi news, Marvel released the Avengers Infinity War first look teaser. And let's take a look at it right now.
Before creation itself, there were six singularities. Forged into infinity stones.
This is our first day. Here we are in Pinewood in Atlanta, and it's actually pretty unbelievable.
Day one of what promises to be a year of fun-filled lensing.
I remember actually going to see the first Avengers with one of my best mates from home, and I'd never have dreamed that I'd ever be in one of these movies, let alone playing Spider-Man. I feel like I'm on top of the world because this is just mind-blowing.
What we always try to do at Marvel Studios is we're building the cinematic universe, is look at the big picture, how can things relate across movies and across years. Avengers Infinity War is the culmination of the entire Marvel Cinematic Universe as started in May of 2008 with the release of Iron Man 1. And it really is an unprecedented culmination of a series of films interlinked together, which at the time had never been done before. And for us, the important thing is making it all come together. We know they're gonna face Thanos. We've been setting that up since Avengers 1. How do you do that in a way that is unexpected, that pits the Avengers against somebody who is more powerful than anyone they faced, and yet make them completely unprepared to face him? Well, tear them apart, which is why we did Civil War before Infinity War.
As we were conceiving and executing Civil War, the end of that movie was very much a setup for what these movies would be. We always had the sense of that.
Tony is now talking to Steve. The Avengers are basically a name with nobody in it. The world is vulnerable.
Tony senses this greater threat approaching, and so he is doing everything in his power to keep the Earth safe.
Thanos shows us why he's the biggest, the best, the baddest villain that we've ever had, and the most frightening villain that the Avengers have ever faced.
The most exciting part is the incredible roster of well-developed characters, and it's going to create a really combustible, exciting, massive-scale adventure.
You know that we're onto something within the studio when we hit upon an idea or we see a piece of concept art and all of us in the room go, this is cool. And in Avengers Infinity War, the Avengers will meet the Guardians of the Galaxy.
Because of what Marvel is, because of what they have done over the last 10 years, these next two Avengers films will be an event like no one has ever seen on film before.
So there you have it, folks. I've been ragging on Warner Brothers about how they've been handling their movies. Please, Warner Brothers, watch this, because this is Kevin Feige, this is Marvel, this is Disney. This is how you make a superhero franchise. They just gave you everything you needed to know in this little teaser trailer. I am so excited to see Avengers Infinity War, Guardians of the Galaxy 2, and everything else that's coming out of Marvel right now. I love this. I think it looks fantastic. Please let me know in the comment section what you think, but holy crap. And I'm a DC fanboy. Like, I love DC. I want them to do well, but you know what? Marvel's just got the right recipe, and I'm just going to enjoy the fact that at least I get great superhero movies from Marvel. So in our next story in sci-fi news, in more disappointing news coming out of Warner Brothers, according to Variety, they've landed on War for the Planet of the Apes director Matt Reeves to direct the yet-untitled Batman movie. Although the script is still in development and Reeves will likely want input on the screenplay, the question now becomes whether or not Warner Brothers can get their ducks in a row to finally make this film happen. Every DCEU picture except for Aquaman has had public and rocky road to production, and while the Batman is now no exception, hopefully it will be smooth sailing as Reeves implements his vision for the movie. It will be interesting to see his take on the character, and especially how it compares with Zack Snyder, who seems to envision Batman as a murderous fascist who might lighten up a little bit in Justice League. The Batman is headed towards a likely 2019 release date, which means that the film should get in front of cameras late this year, after Reeves finishes with the War for the Planet of the Apes, which is due out July 14th. Yeah. I just don't know what to say anymore. I'm not a fan of this guy's movies. Do I think he can do a Batman movie? Sure, why not? But you know what? If they release a crappy Batman movie, I'm going to be so pissed. You had Ben Affleck. You had everything you needed to make a great Batman movie, and you blew it. So anything we watch in Batman now, we're going to know this was your second choice. We're going to know this isn't the movie you wanted. I just hope that you guys will get your act together. And I hope Wonder Woman's great. I hope Justice League's great. But if they're not, if I'm just telling you right now, this is my prediction. If those movies are not absolutely fantastic, I guarantee you this guy won't be directing Batman because they're going to start over. That's my prediction. Let's get on to our next sci-fi news story, and that's production is finally underway on the long-in-development Tomb Raider reboot, and now some new set photos have been revealed, giving us our very first look at Alicia Vikander's Lara Croft in action. Vikander steps into the role of Lara Croft, the only daughter of an aristocrat family who ventures out into dangerous locations in search of ancient artifacts with supernatural powers. Norwegian director Roar Uthog, who directed The Wave, helms the Warner Brothers reboot, which has also Walton Goggins set as villain Father Matthias Vogel, Daniel Wu as ship captain Lu Ren, and Dominic West as Croft's father, Lord Richard Croft. The film is slated for release on March 16th, 2018. And let's just hope Warner Brothers can make this movie happen properly, because I love the Lara Croft franchise. The video game was awesome. The movies with Angelina Jolie I thought were great movies. I hope that they do a good job with this and they can at least get that right. So, our final story in sci-fi news is Perry Nemiroff from Collider Video had an exclusive interview with Kevin Feige from the set of Guardians of the Galaxy and was able to get some clarifying statements about Thanos' role in the upcoming Avengers sequel, Infinity War. She was told that Thanos could be called a main character in the movie. She was also told that Guardians of the Galaxy 2 will take place 3 months after the end of Guardians 1. Peter Quill and the rest of the Guardians are riding high off the reputation they now have because they were holding an Infinity Stone in their hands and actually lived. Now, I love this story. I love the people at Collider, and Perry Nemiroff is one of my favorite on-air talents over there. So I'm really happy that we got this story out of them. Yes, we saw that little teaser trailer, and I can totally see how Thanos would be considered a main character because there's going to be so many characters in Avengers Infinity War. I mean, you've got all of the Avengers, you've got all the Guardians of the Galaxy. They're bringing everyone together. So Thanos will be the one thing that is connecting them all, and you'll probably see a lot of him, and he'll probably come across as a main character. And I'm okay with that because Marvel hasn't really done a great job in the MCU. MCU with their villains. So I'm excited to see them do a great job with their villains. They haven't done a bad job. They just haven't done a super great job. So that's it for Sci-Fi News Weekly show this week. And I'd love to hear what you have to say in the comments section, but I'd really appreciate it if you could subscribe to my channel, click like on this video, let me know that you're out there and that you like what I'm doing. If you want to send me an email, you can send me an email, movieguysci-fi@gmail.com, or please follow me on Twitter, @movieguysci-fi. And remember, everybody, nerds rule the world.